Hello and welcome to the Six at the Belfrey. This is our third service of the day, and my name is Andy Baker. I am the Associate Minister here at the Belfrey. We have a brilliant service lined up for you today. So welcome everyone, welcome for those returning members of our congregation, and welcome to anyone either joining us for the first time or from a different part in the country. We're really glad that you're with us this evening or whenever it is that you're watching this. The service today, we're going to be carrying on our sermon series on freedom. Mike Perkins will be talking to us later on what it means to be free to play. So more of that later. And in a second, Tom Holmes is going to be leading us in worship. So for now, I'm going to pray and I'm going to pray for us as we begin our service. Let's come to this today. We've been doing lockdown church for 7 weeks, 8 weeks nearly, and it's getting familiar now. So I think now is the time for us to really press in, to avoid all the awkwardness and the distractions that are going on around us, and to really seek God. We're going to be thinking tonight about what it means to be free. So let's try and express that freedom in our worship. I'm really encouraging you at home, not just to sit there on the sofa or at the table watching this service and taking it in. I'm going to encourage you this evening to really participate in this service. Sing like you would at church. If you put your hands in the air, do that. If you close your eyes, do that. Whatever it is you feel comfortable doing, let's give our worship to God this evening. He deserves it. So let's pray. Father, we pray this evening that you would come with your Spirit. Father, unite us by your Holy Spirit, that wherever we are, whatever time this is, that you would unite us in our worship of you. And Father, this evening we choose to worship you with everything we've got. In Jesus' name, amen.
Gave it all. sing to you.
Take this opportunity right now. If you're in your front room, watching on TV, on an iPad, watching on your phone, just to pause, invite the Holy Spirit in. And as you sing these words about Him being here and knowing He is moving around us, that doesn't just happen in sacred spaces that we create. Actually, that happens in the sacred space of church at home, as well as the buildings we've gathered in past times. He's still here. He's still working. We have to believe that. We have to believe that. We sing that. We sing it to Him. But we also sing that as a declaration ourselves. God, You are here. We know that You are here. We worship You. We don't worship our phones, we don't worship our cameras, we don't worship to our TVs, we worship You. We thank You for the vehicles that we have to worship in this season. We thank You for times where we can gather together as church. We just pray, as You work in this place, that we would worship. We would worship, we would know a deeper intimacy. God's people said, Amen. We'll sing that verse again. You are here.
Moving in our midst, I worship You. I worship You. You are here, working in this place, and I worship You. I worship You. 'Cause You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who You are. You are way maker, miracle work, promise keep, light in my darkness, my God, that is who You are. You are here, see, touching every heart. I worship You, I worship You. You are here, You're healing every heart. I worship You, I worship You. You are here turning lives, You are here, turning lives around. I worship You. You are here, mending every heart. I worship You, yeah, I worship You. 'Cause You are a way maker, miracle worker,
working. And even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I can't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. That is who you are. That is who you are. King over all, is who you are. Majesty is who you are. Savior is who you are. That is who you are. Yeah, we make miracle work. Promise keep, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Jesus, way make, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretched treasure. How great the pain of sin. Father turns His face away as wounds which mother chosen one bring many sons to glory. on with all my heart. His wounds have paid my ransom. Last verse again. I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. In my ransom.
Thank you, Tom. Let's just take a moment. I don't want to just move on to the next thing. Let's just take a moment just to sit in relative silence, depending on where you are and what you're doing. Let's just have a little moment just to bring ourselves before God this evening in preparation for hearing His word spoken. So just give you just a few seconds of stillness just to prepare yourself. Just ponder on what God's been speaking to you about during the worship. Think about things that you need to confess, worries, burdens, sin that you need to bring before Him. So just do that now. So Father, we come before You as we are. We ask that You would accept this offering of our lives. Father, we pray that now through Your Spirit that You would speak to us Your truth. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. In a moment, we're going to have our reading followed by Mike Perkins, who is going to bring us our sermon for this evening.
So the first reading is from 1 John chapter 4, starting at verse 7 and going to 21. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed His love among us. He sent His one and only Son into the world, that we might live through Him. This is love, not that we loved God, but that He loved us. He sent His Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and His love is made complete in us. This is how we know that we live in Him and He in us. He has given us of His Spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent His Son to be the Saviour of the world. If anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in them and they in Him. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God and God in them. This is how love is made complete among us, so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment. In this world, we are like Jesus. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made complete in love. We love because He first loved us. Whoever claims to love God yet hates a brother or sister is a liar. For whoever does not love their brother and sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. And He has given us this command. Anyone who loves God must also love their brother and sister. The second reading is from Ephesians chapter 1, starting at verse 3 to 14. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. for he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love he predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ, in accordance with his pleasure and will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given to us, the one he loves. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of his grace that he has lavished on us. With all wisdom and understanding, he made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ, to be put into effect when the times reach their fulfilment, to bring unity in all things in heaven and on earth under Christ. In him we were also chosen, having been predestined according to the plan of who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will, in order that we, who were the first to put our hope in Christ, might be for the praise of his glory. And you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. When you believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are in God's possession, to the praise of his glory. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Hello. First of all, thank you so much for those readings. My name is Mike and I'm the curate at the Belfry. I'm married to Emma, who is our assistant children and families worker. And if you've been watching any of our 11 a.m. services, she's the one who's been practicing to be a Blue Peter presenter. It's really wonderful to be speaking to you today, continuing our theme of freedom. And I'll be talking today on the topic of free to play, which I'm genuinely really, really thrilled about. People that know me well, or potentially just follow my wife on Instagram or Facebook, will be aware that we love to play. We love to play board games, we love to be silly, to mess about, to make silly videos. I especially have always loved to just play, whether that's sport or improv or just being generally silly and, dare I say it, maybe even slightly immature. Playing is one of those things that just gives me great joy. So it's genuinely lovely to be able to explore and have a look at why our faith in Jesus gives us a freedom to play. However, when I talk about playing today, I'm not necessarily talking about the sort of playing I did with my action men as a child, where one of them heroically dove off the top of the Christmas tree and snapped his arm off. I'm talking more about the sort of playing that we do as really young children, where we explored everything, found joy in unexpected places, and learned more about what it is to be human. So to help me do that, I'm going to be drawing on some of the themes that we can see in our readings from today, looking at how we can play without fear, we can play as children, and how we can play with the gifts that have been given to us, all because of the freedom we find in Jesus Christ and what he has done for us. But as always, before I dive into all of that, let me just pray. Lord God, thank you. Thank you for the freedom that you give us. Thank you for the freedom to play. Lord, I pray that as we explore these scriptures more now, would you be with us? Would you be teaching us? Would you be guiding us? And Lord, would you help us to play? Amen. So, first of all, we're going to look at playing without fear. Now, you only have to read the first few verses of our passage from John 1 today to see that John is talking a lot about love in this point in this letter. In fact, the word love, or some form of it, occurs around 27 times in just these 15 verses. And if I just reread the first few verses, you'll start to notice that John is really trying to tell us something. He says, "Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins." But hold on a minute, I hear you cry. You said this was play without fear, not play whilst knowing how loved you are. Well, for me, and quite helpfully, for a lot of the commentators on these verses, those two themes are one and the same. We're able to play without fear exactly because we know how loved we are. In his commentary on these verses, John Stott says that fear and love are mutually exclusive. If we are afraid that God is going to punish us, we cannot yet be aware of the fullness of his everlasting love. What he's saying is that we can easily think of God with a mixture of fear and gratitude, always wondering when he might realise that we're not worth it and just give up on us. But that isn't love. John literally says later on in this same passage that perfect love casts out all fear. We don't have to live in anticipation of some punishment being visited upon us because of our past sins or because we don't pray enough or haven't read our Bible enough. Because the God who is love wants his children to have confidence, to live without fear. The fact that God sent his one and only Son to be an atoning sacrifice for our sins means that we can have complete confidence in Jesus, God's Son, and know that we are fully accepted. Okay, so we don't need to fear because we're loved by God. What does that have to do with being free to play? Well, in my experience, fear tends to lead to paralysis. So when we're afraid, we're not free to play. A prime example of this springs to mind was on my first tour with Riding Lights, when we had a sketch in which I was the main character in a kind of panic room or war room type scenario. It was a very fast-paced sketch, a bit of a take on the overly dramatic American shows where a general is in a bunker and his crisis management and everything is going wrong. And during rehearsals, I really, really struggled to learn the lines. They just didn't want to seem to stick in my head. By opening night, I had them learn, they were fine. It still wasn't quite as quick and slick as I would have liked, but they were there. Now, a month or two into the tour, our director came to visit us on the road, just to see how we were, to watch the show, check everything was okay and all as it should be. And I knew this was my chance to prove that this sketch had gotten so much better and that I could absolutely do these lines upside down, backwards, on my head. There was no problem. You may now be able to see where I'm going with this story. So, I was stood on the side of the stage, getting ready to stride on and give my first line of this sketch, but I was nervous. I really wanted it to go well, and I kept repeating the first line over and over in my head to make sure I had it. Because once you get that first line out of the way, you calm down, you get out of your own head, you get your rhythm, and it's all much, much easier. So, I strode out onto the middle of the stage, and the line totally, totally left my head. This line that I had been repeating over and over and over again in my head at the side of the stage totally disappeared. And the only thing that popped into my head was a line from, I kid you not, directly in the middle of that sketch. So I said that. Somehow we muddled our way through. The sketch was fine, we managed to salvage something from it, moved on, and the rest of the show went well. Afterwards, our director was giving us some notes, and when we got to that scene, he looked at me and just said, "Well, that can never happen again." And it didn't. I never dropped another line from that sketch in the rest of the tour, because quite frankly, the worst had already happened. So what did I have to be afraid of? Well, for us as Christians, the worst has happened, and we celebrated it just a few weeks ago. God came to earth as a human being and died a humiliating, awful, painful death. But conversely, it was also the best thing, because it meant that the sin and the wrong in our lives that separated us from having a full and loving relationship with God, who created us, was dealt with and removed. So what is there to be afraid of now? So if we don't have to be afraid anymore, then what is our next move? Well, Tom Wright puts it this way. Those who have been forgiven will demonstrate this revolutionary change at the heart of their life by a new love for one another. God's love supplies both the reason and the resources. If we are truly his children, we shall want to be like our Father. What he's saying is that if people want to see Jesus, they should be able to meet him in the lives of those who follow him. They should encounter his love in the love that we have for one another. And that doesn't just mean in kind words or thoughts and prayers, but practical, down-to-earth actions, the modern equivalent of washing one another's feet. So my question is, what does that look like for you? What is the modern equivalent of the dirty, gross, demeaning jobs? Yes, some are called to be apostles or prophets, teachers or pastors or evangelists, but we're all called to be like Jesus. And he was the one who washed his followers' feet. So how can you do that? How can you play without fear? Especially now in this time of lockdown, when there's so much fear and so much need. Well, as Tom Wright said in that quote, God supplies the reason and the resources. So the first port of call is to go to God and ask him to help you, to give you the eyes to see the need around you. Maybe it's your neighbours or your granny or your local Sainsbury's worker. Ask God first who it is that you can serve and show the love of God to. And then secondly, especially now, to give you the creativity to know how you can do that in a safe way. However, before you do that, I do still have two more points of my sermon to give. So hold that thought and let's explore these passages together a bit more. Because a first practical way of getting started on that journey to in beginning to answer the question of how we can show God's love to one another and how we can play without fear is to play as a child. So if we flip now to our Ephesians reading and look at verses 4 and 5, we'll see that Paul writes about God's plan for us, where he says, "Just as he chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world, to be holy and blameless before him in love, he destined us for adoption as his children through Jesus Christ, according to the good pleasure of his will." First and foremost, we are God's children. And what we see here is that before time even existed, God did something. He formed a purpose in his mind. The purpose involved both Jesus Christ and us. God chose us in Christ. That's a really complicated little phrase. And what it means is that God put us and Christ together in his mind. He decided to make us, who didn't yet exist, his own children through the redeeming work of Christ, which hadn't yet taken place in history. So before the foundation of the world, God chose to come to earth in human form in order to make us holy and blameless so that we could have a relationship with him as our Heavenly Father. God has given everything so that we could be his children. And like children, all we ever want to do is grow up, to be bigger and stronger and more important. But even during his time on earth, Jesus addresses this issue. And we see it played out in Matthew chapter 18, verses 1 to 4, where it says, "At that time, the disciples came to Jesus and asked, 'Who then is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?' He called a little child to him and placed the child among them. And he said, 'Truly I tell you, unless you change and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, whoever takes the lowly position of this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven.'" Now, primarily, these verses are about humility. Children in Greek and Roman culture were not valued. Even in these verses, in the Greek, the child is in the neuter pronoun. It's not a he or a she. They're an it, and that wasn't uncommon. Children were basically seen as a burden, an annoyance, until they reached puberty, at which point they became useful, in most cases because they could now fight or maybe work more effectively, or because they could now bear children. So for Jesus to say to his followers, lower yourself to the level of an it, a nothing person with no value, many of whom were often left to die or just thrown away, sends a strong message about how we should view ourselves and how we should seek to serve others. However, when the disciples asked who was to be the greatest, they were potentially thinking of their heroes of old, with qualities like, leadership ability, courage, prophetic sensitivity. And Jesus tosses all of these out of the window and instead calls for the child, a vulnerable, innocent, trusting, ready to listen, keen to learn, and maybe even to play, a child. So for those of you that have children, you'll be aware of all of these things in your children. Emma and I have three nephews and another niece or nephew on the way. So we get to see these things at a little bit more of a distance and potentially with a little bit more detachment as well. When my nephews, who I adore and love so very, very much, were really, really small, they were, well, let's just say they were as innocent as doves, but maybe not quite as wise as serpents. For example, my sister had put the twins down for a nap one day when a little while later she heard a tremendous amount of wailing and crying from upstairs. Concerned, she rushed to see what was the matter, to find that one of the little cherubs had done a bit of a nappy-busting number two, and in exploring this strange new substance, had smeared it all over everything, sadly, including his mouth, hence the screaming. Children seemingly have no choice but to learn and explore everything. How often do we just assume that we know it all? Well, I don't need to listen to that person or that thing because I know it. I don't need the Bible explained to me because I kind of get it when I read it. Being like a child means being humble and inquisitive enough to want to learn about absolutely everything, no matter where it's come from. Being like a little child also means interacting with our heavenly dad like a little child. Have you ever seen those videos of when a parent comes home from a long trip or even just home from work, and the way their child runs up to them, that level of adoration? God literally created us and chose us before the creation of the world. And sometimes we get too sleepy to pray. There are so many qualities that little children have that will help us to play without fear. Have you ever noticed how fast children make friends, or how quick they are to forgive, how eager they often are to help or to share? God has given us a freedom from our sins. He always planned for us to be able to have this relationship with him as sons and daughters. So let's make the most of it and use this freedom to play as a child. One of the other things about children is that they're always so eager to play with the gifts that they've been given. I mean, obviously, they're also always very keen to play with the cardboard box that it came in, but I think the illustration still holds up. So what is the gift that we have the freedom to play with? Well, if we look back at our Ephesians passage, then we'll see in verses 13 and 14, where Paul writes, "In Christ you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and had believed in him, were marked with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit." This is the pledge of our inheritance towards redemption as God's own people, to the praise of his glory. The gift is, of course, the Holy Spirit. As followers of Jesus, people who have put our trust and faith in him, we're given a gift and a guarantee of our future. My friend at uni was given an inheritance, but he wasn't allowed to touch it until he turned 21. But that's not the case for us. God has given us a great gift and a sign of his love and of what is to come. But instead of it going into a bank account to gather interest until we're old enough and wise enough to use it, we get to, for want of a better word, play with it right from the get-go. If we go right back to the beginning of this Ephesians passage, we see in verse 3 that the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing. Every blessing of the Holy Spirit has been given to us by the Father, if we're in the Son, i.e. if we're followers of Jesus. No blessing has been withheld from us. It's not like a computer game where you get the better equipment and upgrades as you go along. We've been leveled up right from the get-go. Of course, you know, we still have to grow into maturity in Christ and be transformed into his image and explore the riches of our inheritance in him. And of course, too, God may well grant us deeper and richer experiences of him along the way. But nevertheless, if we're in Christ, every spiritual blessing is ours. In chapter 5 of his letter to the Galatians, Paul outlines what the fruits of the Spirit are. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. When God comes to dwell within us by his Holy Spirit, these are the fruits that come with him. So let's not be afraid to play with them. There's a reason Paul calls them fruits of the Spirit. Fruit is good for you. Fruit is a good thing. No one ever said, stop eating all that junk fruit. Or, do you know what? All that fruit is going to kill you one day. And the smart Alex among you, don't give me that whole, if you eat too many bananas, you can die of potassium overdose. Because frankly, I'm not sure that that isn't a myth. And secondly, a banana is a herb. But getting back to God's Spirit. As well as these fruits of the Spirit, there are also gifts of the Spirit, which again, Paul writes about in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Now to each one, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. To one, there is given through the Spirit a message of wisdom. To another, a message of knowledge by means of the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by that one Spirit. To another, miraculous powers. To another, prophecy. To another, distinguishing between spirits. To another, speaking in different kinds of tongues. And to still another, the interpretation of tongues. All these are the work of one and the same Spirit. And he distributes them to each one just as he determines. As Christians, we're enabled to act powerfully through God's Holy Spirit. It could be a word of knowledge that gives someone hope in a dire situation, or wisdom to someone who's struggling. It could be healing for someone in pain, or prophecy for someone who can see no way forward, or any other manner of things. But we are empowered to use these gifts, to seek after them and ask God for more of them. Don't be afraid to ask God for prophetic words or for the gift of healing when you're praying for someone. Embrace the freedom to play with the gifts that you have been given through the Holy Spirit. So hopefully you can see now that the freedom to play comes first and foremost out of knowing that we have nothing to fear, because God loves us. He loves us so much that not only did he die for us, but he decided that would be a price he was willing to pay before he even created us. So knowing how loved we are, this can lead us to a place where we can play as little children do, to explore, to learn, and to wholeheartedly trust God. And finally, therefore, to play with the gifts that we are given, so that in walking in the power of the Spirit, we can become more and more like Jesus, loving people as he loves us, in order to build God's kingdom here on earth as it is in heaven, for his everlasting praise and glory. Amen.
Thanks, Mike, for that. I just encourage you to chew over that The benefit of this being online is that you can go and watch it again. If there's anything that that challenged you or encouraged you, it might be that you choose to re-watch that sermon in the week and actually chew it over and see what God has got to say for you. Normally at the six, we will pray before the service, immediately before, and we'll ask God if he's got anything to say to us. And then we will share those prophecies, those pictures, those Bible verses throughout the service. We're trying to do that still. So I've had a few people praying in the week and they have come up with a few pictures. So I'm going to read these pictures out. If this is totally new to you, just listen. Just see if God has anything to say to you through this. If you listen to these words, and if you feel either moved by any of them, or if you feel I think the way I describe it is your spirit responding to these pictures, that I'd encourage you to pray into these after the service. If you would like someone to pray with you, do get in touch, and we can try and line someone up to have a pray with you in the week. But for now, just see and hear if God has anything to say to you. So the first one, Richard Dearden sent in this painting that someone has sent him. So I think that's going to be on the screen. So I'm going to read the picture that Richard sent with this particular painting. He sensed that many of us will be speaking lies over ourselves that are inconsistent with who God says we are. These lies are almost like self-curses where we allow the enemy in and we limit the freedom that Jesus longs to give us. In particular, Richard hears self-condemnation and shame. Things like, I'll never be a good enough Christian, or guilt. I'll never forgive myself for that thing. He believes this evening that Jesus would say to you, stop listening and partnering with the voice of the accuser. See the lie for what it is, a lie. He's overplaying his hand. The Holy Spirit wants to teach us how to take captive every thought and make it obedient to Christ. That's found in 2 Corinthians 10:5. If this is you, would you ask him to help you become disciplined in this area? We must begin to declare and know the truth, for it is the truth that will set us free. There is no condemnation for those of us who belong to Jesus Christ. You belong to him. The power of the life-giving Spirit has freed you from every curse. Richard also sees there may be some unforgiveness towards others for pain that they have caused. There's almost a holding on to that pain for fear that letting go would negate that justice. People might be holding on to hurtful words that have been spoken over them. These are almost like curses as well. He feels the Lord wants to release some people from this bitter and this anger. We are not called to be victims, but sons and daughters. Life's too short. We mustn't let the sun go down while we're still angry and risk giving the enemy a foothold. Richard says he feels Jesus would firmly remind you of the following scripture, and both for freeing consequences of forgiveness, but for the warning of unforgiveness. The scripture is Matthew 6:14-15. For if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. It's a powerful verse, and often we jump to the latter part of it and hear negative criticism. But actually, in that verse is a great amount of freedom and release. For when we forgive other people their sins against us, Heavenly Father forgives us. So God is willing to forgive us. We need to just let go of these things. He says the Holy Spirit wants to help us make an active decision and choice to forgive until we can get to the place of freedom where we can, from Luke 6:28, bless those who curse us and pray for those who hurt us. That's quite a big one. If you would like some prayer for that, please do get in touch. But if there's some stuff in there that you could process on your own, then feel free to maybe rewatch this again. Another person sent in a picture. She had a picture of a crazy windstorm on a motorway, and there was a car that was continuing at a really fast speed with the window wipers going full speed. The other people had pulled over and turned off the wipers, and they were just still. She thinks this might relate to people who are becoming restless at home and maybe feeling guilty about being still when there's so many people having to work more and more hours. But she feels that God is saying to you, it's okay to be still. There's a Bible verse, which is Psalm 46:10. She says you can work inside the car when it's still, but not when it's going so fast in a storm or in lockdown. she thinks that God wants to remind people that he's changed the pace in people's lives. So just allow him to do what he wants to do right now. She thinks that might be for a few people out there. I've got two more short ones. The first one is for a woman with a multicoloured scarf. You might be wearing it now. You might not. You might just have one. The picture is that you might be feeling low because you aren't able to practice hospitality, which is something that you're gifted in. The message this evening is that you're able to host the presence of God. So your house is a house of God. So turn that hospitality to God. Invite him in and host that presence. The final word, it says it might feel like you're just passively waiting for the quarantine to end, but they need you to know that God is actually cultivating your relationship. Like with natural relationship, things take time to grow. You might be holding on to pain, possibly physical, possibly emotional. Don't be afraid to give it to him, because he is able to do immeasurably more than you can ask or imagine. He is a gentle and patient God. So just to encourage you again, I've already said it, but if any of those pictures or words resonated with you, maybe find someone that you trust who would be willing to pray that with you. Feel free to go back over those words and have a look at them after the service has ended. But if you're stuck and you need someone, please do get in touch with us, and we can hopefully help you find someone who'd be willing to pray for you online. Also, just to add to that, if there's anyone watching who would not identify yourself as a Christian, actually you're maybe feeling drawn to God at this time. You might be, this might be literally the first time you've engaged, or you might be dipping into other churches throughout the week or throughout the last few weeks. If that is you, and actually you're feeling, actually I want to explore this more, I want to know what it is to be a Christian, I'd encourage you to please get in touch with us. You can email us at hello@belfrey.org, and we will connect you with someone who can process some of that with you. But if tonight, if you feel like you'd like to become a Christian, please, please, please get in touch. Don't be shy. We don't bite. We're not scary. We won't take your bank details. We just want to pray with you to encourage what God's doing in your life. I've got a few notices. The first one is an exciting, fun thing. We're launching today a new campaign called 30 Seconds of Kindness. And for the next couple of weeks, 2 weeks, we're going to be collecting video testimonies of what you've been seeing God do in this time, how he's touched your life and those of your friends, family, loved ones, or even just things that you're thankful for at the moment. We're going to be sharing those videos on Sunday and social media. So if you send them in, you need to know that. So our challenge to you is to make a 30 second video and send it to us for these 30 seconds of thankfulness. It can be a really outrageous thing if God's done something spectacular in your life. Maybe you've become a Christian, maybe you've experienced a level of healing, but we also need to be sharing with one another the little things that God has been doing, the things that you're thankful for when you've just really appreciated something or someone's done a really small act of kindness for you. You can find the details of what we're doing on the website, which is belfrey.org/30 seconds. The words, I think, at the bottom of the screen. But do send those in. Also, check out the website if you need to connect with us. If you're looking for a buddy, if you're looking for a Belfrey group, you can go and check all that out at belfrey.org. Also, we are able to carry on giving. We're really grateful for those of you who are giving online or via direct debit. The work of the church is obviously still going on. You're participating in that tonight. But we're also giving to our mission partners around York, around England and around the world. And that money is supporting them do these incredible things. So if you would like to give as a one-off, because normally you do that in the service, or you just feel called tonight to give something, then visit belfrey.org/giving. Finally, we trialled coffee after each of our services last week. We're going to do it again this week to see how that works. The email is, the website address is below. It's belfrey.org/coffee. There's a new password this evening. That password is North 6, capital N and the number 6. That will get you into the Zoom chat. So visit belfrey.org/coffee for the link to the chat, and the password is North 6, capital N, number 6. We're going to go into our final song, which will be led by Tom, and then I'm going to close off our service with a blessing.
I trust in you. In my hour of need, I look to you. When my way is lost, I call on you. Knowing you will hear my cry. So I follow you, though the way is costly, I give to you. When my heart feels empty, I'll bow to you. To see you lifted high. Oh, you are my sure and firm foundation, God Most High, my strength and my salvation, Jesus Christ. I'm calling out for more of you, more of you. Your heart is good, you're a faithful Father. You died for us, you're the Son, our Savior. Abide with us,
more of you.
Thanks, Tom. Just in between recording these little sections, I just had a little inkling from God just to remind you all that if any of those words previously resonated with you, please get in touch with us. We'd love to pray with you. If you've not got someone that you could call that would be willing to pray with you, then please do get in touch with us. We'd love to pray with you. And also, I have a sense that a few people have been moved in particularly in the worship tonight. And again, if that's you, my prayer is that God would just seal whatever he's done in your hearts this evening. I'm going to finish the service off with a short blessing and just to give a little reminder that if you would like to join us for virtual coffee after the service, please visit the website belfrey.org/coffee and the password will come on the screen at the end of this service. So do join us just for a short chat where we'll be able to just see each other's little faces, which will be lovely. So I'm going to pray for us. So thank you, Father, for everything that you've been doing in our church and in our world throughout this time. Father, we pray that you would seal these things deep within us. And I pray the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with each one of you and remain with you now and with all of your friends, family, and loved ones. In Jesus' name, amen. See you again soon.